Hello, welcome back. It's been a couple of weeks, but we are back at it. And in this episode, we're going to be taking a look at our Breaking Bad-esque escape room game. And in this one, I want to have a look at how you can interact with UI. And now at the moment, we've got our hands in VR, which is cool, and we can also activate our teleporters. But how can we also then automatically interact with some UI elements around the scene? Well, in this episode, we're going to take a look. Let's dive right in. If you're like me and love everything to do with gaming, game development and new technologies, then check out my channel. I've got dozens of videos on how to create your own games and the latest in tech. And if you like what you see, why not consider a subscription? Thanks very much and enjoy the video. So I very quickly want to show you what I'm talking about. If I just fire up play here and let's hop into VR, wait for it to turn on. Right, so here we are. This is the tutorial we built last time when we made our puzzle. And it's just taken everything we've done so far in the lab, so you can check out those previous videos if you don't know. But in this one, we've got the ability to teleport, and we've got the ability to move around the scene and pick things up, and that's all cool. But what happens if you want to interact with some UI using this technique? Well, you don't want to use the same ray that we're using here for the teleport. It's like a completely separate system, and we only want that system to do one job, and that's teleport. But how can we control our UI elements? What we're going to do in this one is we're going to create a UI element that when we get near it and we point our hand at it, you get the XR ray interactor for the UI, and then you can interact with that and do different things. And we're going to use this technique to be able to allow us to enter our key code in a little UI panel that allows us to escape the room. So let's see how we can put all these systems together and make them work seamlessly so it's really easy for the user. Let's dive right in. Here we are, so back in our lab. It's kind of dark, so let's fix that first. There we go, we can actually see what we're doing now. The first thing we're gonna need to make is a UI. So let's go ahead and make a canvas, and we'll call this our key code, or what would you call that, a key code panel. And this is gonna be a world space canvas. I can go ahead and drop the main camera in there, the event camera, which is under your XR origin. And let's put it in the middle so we know where it is, and give it a width. Doesn't need to be massive. Let's say it's 40 centimeters by 60 for a minute, just so we can get it all designed up. See where it is. There it is over there. The player starts here. We don't want to go too far. We can place it anywhere we want later on. Let's go ahead and rotate it around the player. Let's go ahead and put a panel in there so we can see where it is. Click on none for the background. We'll go ahead and just make it like a solid black. There we go. I can put some text in there. Use Text Mesh Pro. We're going to import the TMP Essentials. Close that down. And it's massive. So we'll go ahead and fit that to our box by clicking on the Rect Transform. I'm just going to hold down Alt, which is going to fit it to the frame. Let's just resize it just so it's a little title at the top. We need to reduce the font size. We're back to front. Let's spin it around and we'll change the text to key code, and we'll go ahead and put that in the middle like so. And whenever you create a UI, you also get an event system created as well. And if you look on that one, it's got a standalone input module. We don't want that. We're going to remove it. We're going to click on the three dots, remove component, and we're going to add in the XR UI input module. And all those settings are good by default. You can go ahead and leave those. Then if you click on the actual canvas itself, we are going to want just put XR graphic, let's put graphic raycaster. There you go, tracked device graphic raycaster. You also want that on your canvas. Now we've got that all set up, let's just add a little bit of detail to our key code panel. Let's add in some buttons, UI, and we'll add in a button, text mesh, whoa. Let's mesh, whoa. Let's fit that to the box. Let's go ahead and remove the thingy. Scale it down to a good size for the button. It's gonna change the size of these gizmos. Change the size of the text, the font size to 0.25, and let's just put in like one. And we'll shrink down the size of this button a little bit, make it square. And we can move that into position. That's our first button. Then we can duplicate that. I'm gonna change that button's name, something a little bit more logical. So we'll call it button one, duplicate. We've got button one, change that to button two. There we go. change the text to 2. We'll leave it there for a minute, just so you see it gets the idea. All we've done is created a UI that's got a couple of buttons in it. We've added the track device graphic raycaster to the canvas and also the XR UI input module to our event system. It's nice and easy so far. As I said, we don't want to use our teleporters to interact with this. We just kind of want it to happen automatically. But in order for that to happen, to start off, we're going to need to create the raycaster that's going to be used for the canvas. So in the next part, let's take a look at that. Okay, so the easiest way to add in another ray interactor is I'm just going to create another in my hierarchy, so right click anywhere and go to XR origin action based, hit enter, and we're just going to borrow it. I'm going to steal the right hand controller, it's control D, and I'm going to quickly rename that to our UI ray interactor, and I'm going to move it to our current, our proper XR origin, and stick it in there. And I'm gonna get rid of that XR origin we just created. And we're left with our old one where we've got our right hand, left hand, very nice. And our UI ray interactor. This is our one that's gonna interact with our UI here. And currently this is all good. So when we hit play, we should be in our scene and able to use that ray to click on the UI button, so you can see it's changing there. So it's on all the time at the moment, but that's okay. And we come up to our key code, we go bleep, 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 and we'll be able to press those buttons. So the ray is working, which is great. But like I said, we don't want that on all the time. So we are going to turn it off. But we need to know two things. One, how close we are to the UI, because we're going to automatically activate that ray interactor. But we also need to know that we're pointing at UI. And we're going to be a bit cheeky here. We're going to kind of use a collider behind this UI panel. And we're going to raycast from our hand out in the forward direction so that when you point at the UI, if it detects that you're there, it's automatically going to fire that ray and you can interact with the UI in the traditional VR sense. So let's go ahead and we'll have a look at creating a, first of all, we're going to create the collider that we need. So we're going to go right click, we're just going to create a cube for a minute, and we're going to position this somewhere near our UI. Time lapse, please. There we go. So I've got my collider all in place, and I'm just going to go and turn off my mesh renderer. So we just have a collider here. And I'm going to rename this keypad UI collider. And now I've got that in there. Oh, I could have done that neater. Let's see. I think I've messed up, and I'll tell you why. Because the scale has gone weird. And I want to be able to keep my scale at 1, so if I want to add anything onto my key code later, well, the scale doesn't go funny. So what I was going to do was drag my key code panel into my keypad collider, but I am not going to do that. I should have left my scale for my object 111 and edited the size of the collider separately from the transform scale. That would have been the proper thing to do. Bad Dan. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to create an empty game object, and I'm going to call this keypad. This is going to keep my scale consistent. I am going to put that keypad into my keycode panel, which is my UI. And I'm going to center it at 0, so it's going to snap that transform all the way to wrong place. Okay, and 0 on that. It's got 0, 0, 0, and let's move that transform to the center of my panel. I'll pull it out, and now that transform's in the right place. So I'm gonna put my keypad collider in there. I can also put my key code panel in there, and that key gives us a nice little game object with the scale set correctly if I want to add any art later to it. Cool. But yeah, really, I shouldn't really have adjusted my collider. So it was a funny scale. I should have done it through the edit collider button. Anyway, so now we need to create our ray casting script to turn on our ray interactor when we are near our UI. Let's do that right now. Let's go to our scripts folder. I'm going to go to right click and I'm going to create a new C# script and I'm going to call this user interface activation, ray activation. So good at my names. Kaboom! User interface ray activation. And we're going to drop this on our XR origin of all places. Or I could do it on the right hand. Let's do that. Let's take it off of the XR origin. Let's just keep that neat. And on our right hand, because this is the one we're going to use for our UI, let's put the user interface ray activation script on there. And we'll double click it to open up. And this is going to be so simple, this script. All we're literally doing is going to ray cast out from the hand position. And if we're within range, say like 2 meters, it's going to activate our ray when we point at the panel. So we don't want to be like facing away from the panel and the ray is still on. That would just be weird. So we only want to do it when it's pointing at the UI. So let's take a deep dive into that script. Let's bring it over here. I'm going to turn me off so you can concentrate. Righto, let's do this funky shizness. Let's double click on our, let's make this a bit bigger so you can actually see what's going on. A little squinting. Hopefully that's a bit better. And we are going to get rid of these. It's a garbage. We don't need them. We are going to need a few variables. So let's go ahead and we'll make these all serialized fields because we want to see them in the inspector. I like to use the private keyword just because reasons. And I want a private transform. And this is going to be my linked hand position. And that's just the object that we're going to be raycasting from effectively, right hand in a minute. That's just a point in space to right raycast from. Go ahead, semicolon that up. And then we'll go serialize field again, private. And we're going to use a layer mask. And that's going to be a way of separating out when our ray hits something. If it's on a certain layer, it will discard it. Or if it's on the right layer, it'll pass it through to some if statements. So it just saves us a lot of headaches later on. We don't want it to keep colliding and hitting everything. So we're going to use a layer mask to control what we're hitting. So we're going to call that layer mask layer to hit. So only hit things on a certain layer. And then another serialized field. And this is a throw. And this is going to be our max distance from canvas. This is how close we are going to have to be to our canvas in order to actually activate it. Now, we're going to be using events to say, hey, yo, we're in range and pointing at our canvas. So we're going to go using Unity Engine dot events. And we can put it down here. I like to use headers. So it shows up within the inspector what we're doing. That's a bit neat. We can say UI hover events. We want to know when we started our hover and when we've ended our hover. That's going to basically control our ray visibility. So these are going to be public Unity events. And we're going to do one for when we started the hover with our hand. UI on, crap, on UI hover start. And we'll do one for when we come off the canvas. So public T event and on UI hover end. That's our Unity events. Now, we need to be able to kind of keep track of what current mode we're in. And by that, I mean, when we've activated our UI pointer, we need to check every frame where we're still looking at the canvas. And that's just going to help us out with all the logic later on. So we're going to use an enum to just keep a track of our current interactor state, whether we're in the default mode and just teleporting around, or whether we're in the UI mode and pointing at the UI. So if you haven't used enums before, they're pretty cool. You can use them to keep track of states. At least that's how I'm going to be using one. I'm going to call it current interactor state. And we're going to have two type of states in our game. We're going to have a default mode, which is, like I said, teleporting around. Or, separate by a comma, we're going to be in our UI mode. And then finish off with a semicolon. So that sets up the enum, if you like. But we need to create a variable of type current interactor state to be able to actively use it. So we'll create a private current interactor state. So we're creating an instance of the enum. And we'll call it current interactor mode. And Unity's got some good tutorials on how enums work, so maybe worth checking them out if you're not too familiar. I use them quite a lot just to keep track of things, control things, which is pretty cool. So we need to set what mode we're in. So by default, when we start a game, we're going to be in the default mode. And we can use our awake function to control that, or method, whatever you prefer. I don't given up caring these days. But we can say that our current interactor mode is going to be equal to current interactor state dot default mode. We're going to be in our default mode for the UI. And we can make this, we can tidy this up even more. We can use an expression body, and that's going to put it all on one line for us. Left click on current interactor mode, control, full stop. And you see it says use expression body for methods here. Go ahead and do that. Sweet. And because we're ray casting, we're going to be using the physics system. We're going to use fix update instead of update. Then we're going to say private void fixed update. And we're going to do a couple of things in this update. Not nearly there, trust me. But these are quite, this is where all the bulk of it's going to go. I'm basically going to have a logic statement in here that's monitoring the current state we're in and if we're ray casting against our UI. So we want to create, we're going to create a local ray cast hit. We're going to call it hit. And then we're going to do an if statement. Don't forget semicolon like me. Stupid. And we'll go if, we're going to use our physics system here, so we can say if physics dot raycast, and we need to tell it to raycast from, and that's going to be our linked hand position dot position, and we're going to be casting out from our hand in the forward direction, so in front of us, so we say linked hand position dot forward. And we're going to store everything in hit that we hit and a comma. And we're going to put in a distance. So we're going to say that's going to be our max distance from canvas. And we're also going to be checking to see what layer we've hit. So we're going to use our layer mask that we created, which is called layer to hit. So if we're within distance and we've hit our layer, then we're actually looking at our UI, or we're pointing at our UI, and we need to check what state it's in. Are we already looking at the UI? So we can check that because we've created our current interactor state. So if our current interactor state, which is stored in current interactor mode, and we can say if current interactor mode is not equal to current interactor state dot UI mode. So in other words, we're in default mode. Then we can activate our UI. So we can say on hover start, we're going to call it, we're going to fire off our event to say, looking at the UI, y'all. Invoke. Bang. So it's going to fire that event. But because we're now looking at the UI, we need to change our current interactor mode because we're no longer in default mode. To say current interactor mode is going to be equal to current interactor state dot UI mode, because we're now looking at the UI. So what happens when we if we come through here and we are in fact in our UI mode? Well, that's okay. We can say else if our current UI mode is equal to current interactor state dot UI mode, then we want to end our UI interaction. We're no longer looking at it. So we can say on hover end dot invoke. And then don't forget, we also need to change our current interactor mode because we're not looking at the UI anymore. So we can say current interactor mode equals current interactor state dot default mode back to normal. Let's just run through that. That's actually done. Let's just run through that very quick. So namespaces, boom. Don't actually need two system ones. Got some serialized fields, a hand position, the layer we want to hit, and the max distance from the canvas. And we're going to control our UI visibility or our ray interactor visibility through some events. We're using an enum to monitor what current state we're in, whether we're still in our default mode of teleporting around, or whether we're in our UI mode and pointing at the canvas. And on awake, we're setting our current interactor mode to default. And then every frame or every physics update, I think it's like 50 frames a second or something like that, we're checking to see what we've hit. So we're casting a ray out from our hand position. And if we hit something that is within distance or within range and it's against the right layer, we're going to have a look to see what UI mode we're in, because we've hit something. We've obviously hit the UI because it's on the right layer, but we need to see whether we're already looking at the UI. And if we're not, then we're going to activate the UI. If we are already looking at the UI and we're raycasting against it, then we don't need to do anything. So that's why it just kind of ends there. But if we go around, if the physics raycast hasn't hit anything, then we're obviously not looking at the UI. So we need to turn off UI mode. And we're checking to see that we're already in UI mode. And if we are, it's going to end it. And it's going to set the current state to default mode. If we already happen to be in default mode, then this just doesn't get done. And we're already in our default state. So nothing to worry about. So let's jump back into Unity quickly. Let's make sure I've saved this. And it's going to do a little bit of compilation. I'm going to put my beautiful face back on. And we're going to set some stuff up. Right, so we've got our right hand here. We've got our UI ray interactor, which we created. We're going to drag and drop our right hand UI ray interactor in there. This is all now stored in our right hand. You could do one for your left if you wanted to. And we're going to drop in our linked hand position. This is going to be our direct interactor. We don't really want to connect it to our ray interactor. We'll just do it to our default hand. So we're dragging our direct interactor hand into our linked position. And then we would need a layer to hit against. And we're going to create a new layer. Let's go to our keypad. And where it's got layer, we've got layer here. Click on add layer. And let's click on, let's make a new layer called VR UI. And hit enter. Click on keypad again. And we'll still need to change the layer to VR UI. Yes, change children. And we'll go to our ray interactor. We'll go to our right hand where we've got our script. And where it's got layer to hit, we're going to select a VR UI. So it's only going to be hitting. That ray is only going to be causing a collision against stuff, against the VR UI layer. Max distance from canvas. So how close do you reckon we'll need to be? Well, for this, you might say you want to be like 2 meters away from the canvas. So go ahead and put two in there. So this is where all the good stuff happens with our UI pointer. It's all controlled through our hover events. So we're going to click on plus and on our on UI hover start, we're going to need to activate our ray interactor and drag and drop it in, go game object, set active. And then we're not looking at our UI anymore. We've moved away from it. Let's just turn it off. God damn, that's so simple. I like to keep things simple. You may have, if you've watched my tutorials, you know, simple all the way. So I think that might be it. Let's test it. Let's jump into VR. Probably isn't going to work now. Let's have a look. Ah, the joys of game development. Why can't I see anything? Okay, so no UI pointer. UI! Oh, snap! That's good. So I'm on my UI. I can interact. Click on all the buttons. Still got my hand. You see it goes red a bit. That's because our collider will just go past the bounds of the UI a little bit, which is a big deal, I don't think. So yeah, we can move around as normal. Got a teleporter there. And let's pick one. We'll go over here. Over here. Let's point back at our UI. All the way over there. That doesn't work. Stupid. And it still doesn't work. And I can't get back to it because I've got no teleport point over there. Dumbass. So let's move this key code. That's just for the hell of it. Let's just go and put it over here. Up against this unit. Let's put it on there. There we go. Shit. Sorry, microphone. So I can't interact with it. I can teleport over. Oh, look. It's a key code. Boom. I can interact with the UI. And why has it gone red? Bring that forward a bit. I reckon there's a collider here or something that's giving it grief. Yeah, there we go. Cool. So now we can go blip, 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 blip. And we can interact with our key code. So what the idea is, if you haven't guessed already, is that from our last tutorial, we built like a little puzzle using XR socket interactors and putting things in the right order, which will give you a number at the end. And then once you've got, say, four numbers, you would go up there to the door. I'll go up there at the minute and come up to our key code and we'll go, okay, let's try and figure out this code. So we'll go ding, 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 ding. And you'd enter your code, which will then let you out of the room before it explodes. But yeah, that's really cool. So now we've got all the same, all the normal interactions. We can teleport around and we can pick stuff up if there was anything to pick up. And then we can interact with any UI elements really easily, I think, and, you know, really neatly as well. I haven't got any extra buttons to faff around with. It just kind of happens for you. And you just pull the trigger and press the buttons. Alternatively, you know, you could create a really kind of elaborate system where you could actually touch the buttons, which is, again, more realistic. This is like a quick and dirty way to interact with UI. I suppose on a more generic level, if you had like an option screen or something, but I think it's pretty neat to know how to do it. So that's how you would go about creating that UI pointer along with all the stuff we've got. Now, one thing you may have noticed is that you can activate your teleporter and also interact with the UI. That's a feature, not a bug. But in all seriousness, if you're looking at the UI, you could then, in the event section of that script, you could turn off the script that's checking for the teleport toggle. And then when you've come away from it, turn it back on again. That's the power of events. So there we have it. So this project is actually still up on my Patreon page. You can grab it from there. Man, it's got all the goodness in, all the 3D models, and everything we've done to date as well. But that said, you don't need to. You could quite easily create, following the tutorials, you could quite easily create the same systems that we've put in place here by following along with those two. Don't forget to subscribe if you're not already to stay up to date with new stuff. I try and do it as much as I can to keep you all happy and learning some Unity and VR. But that's it for this week. I'll catch you in the next one. Take care.